Welcome back to the Floating Thimble Podcast. I'm your host, Luke, and today we are introducing a new series that we're going to do in between our main series. We'll do it occasionally, and obviously it's not going to be like a thing we do every time, probably, but we'll see when we go through it.
When we feel like it, basically.
Yeah. And so it's pick a movie, and our theme today will be silent movies, and so we all picked one for today, and we're all going to review them. So my podcast hosts for today are Dany.
Hello.
And Blake.
What's up?
And I guess we can go ahead and get into them.
Starting with Prince Achmed, right?
Yeah, so Dany, you picked Prince Achmed.
We're going by the order they came out in.
Kind of,
basically.
Yeah. Basically, yeah.
Adventures of Prince Achmed and A Page of Madness are both 1926, so we're going to just start with the one we like worse, apparently.
Wow.
Yeah, well, unfortunately.
Let's be honest. We'll just put all chaos of cards on the table, you know?
But
it's true, though.
Yeah.
And we'll get into it. I guess that's a good way to
Pick it, though? I think we should start with.
Yeah, okay, we'll start there. Well, the main reason I picked it was more just kind of... when I thought I'd pick a silent movie, I wanted to go, and I was looking through the movies I've seen. This one felt like it had another reason more than just I like it. It's basically the oldest surviving feature silent movie.
It's the first animated silent
feature. It basically
feature,
is. I'm pretty sure it is, because this technique had not been done before her.
Yeah.
And kind of learning more about that process, there's a documentary on Criterion about her that came out in like 1999, just about like her career and kind of everything about her career. And there's a professor on there basically talking about, like, she was the first to really have this idea and do animation, like, literally just by herself creating silhouettes. And really, that's why I wanted to pick the movie, those two things. I love the silhouettes designs in this movie, and I just love the histories of things, and I really do love animation at the end of the day, so just knowing that this is the first one, like, that, you know, that kind of just makes it special on its own. And we'll kind of talk about it just maybe as the movie, just by itself, is not the greatest movie, you know? But to me, if you're making the first animated movie, we can let that slide.
Yeah, for sure.
The importance is enough.
Yes, especially when you learn the crew they had was not that big. It was like four or five people making this movie.
Yeah,
it took them 3 years, and they're just basically making it in like an attic on a table, basically frame by frame. You know, and like Disney has like hundreds of animators, and it still takes them forever to make these movies.
Yeah,
you know, because it's not easy to do animation. No matter like obviously the frame rate is different and everything, but still. It's very hard to do. And all those reasons is really why I picked it. And I guess if I had to say one more reason, just the colors. You know, I love the colors. And, okay, what about you guys? What do you guys think of the movie? Was it worth watching?
Well, I watched it for the first time. And, like you said, I do respect, like, as a movie, like, the importance it has as being the first animated feature. But... my main like problem with it, which is something that you loved about it, is the silhouettes. Personally, I don't know if anyone else felt this way. It's probably just me. I don't know. And I mean, okay. I don't know if it's like actually like. Okay, I like the look of the silhouettes, but for me, like, for me to get engaged with the story and the characters, like it was hard for me, because it almost alienated them, in a way, and it's hard to explain. But like, I don't know. It's just it was. I don't know if it was... it could be that just the characters weren't very good. And maybe I see the silhouettes and I'm like, okay, that's the reason. Mm-hmm. But that was really... the story and the characters, I don't know. I just wasn't super into. And it was beautiful, though. And I definitely do respect it as a film... as its place in film history. But really, that was my problem.
No, I disagree, actually, honestly. I love the art style, but I actually disagree because I think the silhouettes do... I think they're very, like, expressionistic. Like, I think the expressions, like, without having any discernible features, like, they make these silhouettes kind of express emotions pretty well, and I think they get the emotions across for the most part. Where I think it, like, I just think the story's kind of weak. Or at least, like, maybe it's not weak, but I just haven't read it, Arabian Nights, you know? So, like, maybe I know Dan and I were talking about this. Maybe we just missed something. Yeah. Or we just don't know.
We just don't know
the characters as well as people that would have watched this in 1926 would have known them. Mm-hmm. But I love the silhouette. Like, the main reason I love this movie, because I know me and you had seen it before this, was because it is the first anime movie, but I love the silhouette for art style. Like, ever since, like, I love art, and I love Greek art, too, and they always would paint with the silhouettes. Like, you know, like, that would be, like, their paintings and stuff. Yeah. So it is kind of just, like, kind of like a painting come to life whenever you think of it like that, because...
think about the story. It's a very classical story.
Yeah, it's a very classical,
that have been reinterpreted a lot, you know, ever since.
For me, it's not an aesthetic problem. It's just a story problem.
So, when you say that, then, it doesn't even sound like you're really saying you have a problem with the silhouettes, then.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't know if it's specifically the silhouettes. Okay. I just think the silhouettes might have something to do with it.
Okay.
And it's kind of why I identified it as what probably is the problem for me.
I definitely... we can definitely... Because Blake made a good point about this, where if you don't know it might be made towards an audience that knew the characters already, Aladdin and Achmed. You know, they at least had probably some understanding of this history, and she's probably assuming
They might have known why the witch didn't like the magician or something like that, and we just never know that. We just know that she's like, why would the magician drop Achmed off right in her mountain, like one of his biggest villains, like her enemies, like mortal enemies? Like, why would he just do that? So that she could free him, basically. Like, there are just a lot of little things like that I don't personally get, but maybe if I would have read Arabian Nights, I would have.
And that's why, because when I talked about it with you guys, I was saying how I might not rate it this time, and that's the main reason I wanted to say that, was because it felt like almost watching, like, if I watched, like, the 7th Marvel movie or something, and then I complained that I didn't know any of the characters, and people were like, you didn't do your background, you know, like,
you didn't watch Phase One,
or like, really, it just wasn't made for you, you know. Obviously, if it's made for an audience that knows these characters in Germany at the time, then, like, can I really complain to be like, I didn't connect to the characters, like, she wasn't making it to where you were supposed to connect with the characters, you know, like, it feels more like just for the art style itself, right, just for the art to let it, just for the form making itself. Yeah. And that's why she used a very popular, at the time, probably a more popular story than for us today.
But whether or not my feelings on this movie, I am glad it exists.
Oh,
yes,
sure.
Yes. No, it's just so creative, you know?
It is extremely creative.
And something I learned in that documentary was Jean Renoir was a huge fan of this movie and both of them. Because, like, her and her husband, they, like, basically produced and made movies their whole lives. And he's the one that helped her get this made, too. But Jean Renoir also started working with her husband a lot on some of his movies, his scripts too.
Her name's Rainberg?
Lott Reniger. So, and her husband's named Carl Koch, I think. So, those two. And it really is both their movie too, and she basically says that, like, he actually controlled more of the story aspects of it, like the directing, and she was, you know, she was more of the straight artist, like, cutting the silhouettes, framing them in all the right places, you know, and definitely having good ideas too. Let's get into the actual movie. I don't even think we've actually gotten to the movie itself. One of my favorite scenes, and to me, like, at a certain point really, like, comes alive, is when he's hiding from, like, the demons when they come to take baths, and you don't know they swim.
Yeah.
You don't know they fly. They fly in, and then they just take off their wings, too. It's just, like, a great moment. To me, like, the silhouettes work perfectly in those kind of moments.
They do.
You know? Like, the flying horse and stuff like that. Where it just feels natural, but, you know, you can make silhouettes easily fly, right? At the same time.
You can.
I did like the scene, too, with the silhouettes. I'm with the silhouettes in the whole movie. But they were, like, trying to, like, entertain the king, and they were, like, stacking on top of each other?
Yes.
I was like, damn, that's cool.
Those three guys.
Yeah.
And honestly, that scene, I don't know if you thought of this, but it reminded me of that scene in Parade, Tati's Parade, when they're doing the person stack.
Okay,
you know?
Yeah.
I was like, it's a long tradition of that.
Jimmy's not that bad after all.
Not joking. It only took bringing up Tati. No, one of my favorite scenes in this movie, and it plays into, like, the expressions that these silhouettes give and how I actually think they're really believable. And the scene that I think best shows that is whenever Prince Achmed and I can't remember the princess's name, but they all fly back.
Yes, it starts
and
with
then
D.
with Aladdin, like, Aladdin's there too, and they meet the father, and then, like, the princess, Achmed's sister, comes out, and then she takes, like, his wife, who's going to be Achmed's wife, up to see the king, and she's, like, very hesitant, like, no, I don't want to go see him, like, what if he doesn't like me, basically, or something like that. At least that's the expression she's giving off. And then, like, the acceptance, like, whenever the king just accepts everyone. I don't know, it's just, like...
The way the movie ends, with the morning prayer and everything.
Yeah, the expressions, like, silhouettes, you wouldn't expect them to be able to give off the expressions they do, but they do in this movie. And that's one of the reasons I do like it still a lot. But,
okay,
yeah.
So before I get, because I want to mention something, and she was very specific on, like, why she used silhouettes. Like, she had, you know, and that's basically why, you know, like, she thought they were very expressionistic for being so simple,
yeah.
You know, at the same time. And there's this great quote at the end of the documentary that I was going to save to the end, but it's perfect for what we're talking about now. I'll just quote it. Quote, "What can be less of a person's image than his silhouette? And how much can this express? Less gold, but the purest." You know? And that's kind of how she saw it. It's like, less gold, but the purest kind of gold, right?
Yeah.
It's just that... It's literally just the expressions itself.
It is, yeah.
Right? That's
yeah.
all you're watching. And that's kind of what I love. But specifically, I want to mention some of the characters specifically. And I think maybe the most expressionist is the magician.
I think he is,
like, honestly, it made me think that this movie might have been better if it was just about him or his character, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it was one of the first movies where, like, oh, I wish they would stay on the villain more, you know?
Okay.
Because, like, the characters... The story does kind of feel simplistic, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you're not watching it for the story kind of thing.
No, you're watching it for the art.
Yeah, exactly. But do you guys have any specific moments or anything, like...
You'll
think of maybe when you think of this movie.
I mean, there are so many good scenes. Like, it's the thing. Like, there are so many good action scenes. Like, even just the one that pops into my mind is the one with the snake.
Whenever the snake comes out,
he uses it, like, he chokes it out and uses it for a ladder or for, like, a rope to climb out.
No, that's not the one I'm thinking of. I'm thinking of one where the two people fight, where one of them turns into a lion, one of them turns into a snake,
yeah,
and they
yeah.
both start turning into random animals
yeah.
while they're fighting. That's actually a great scene, too. Like, it feels like very naturalistic, the story, but you can do so many things with silhouettes at the same time, which is
yeah.
great, which is like makes it kind of a fun watch. Like, you don't know what's going to happen next with the silhouettes almost. And like, one of my favorite moments of that is when the magician specifically is taking Achmed over hell. Like, I think it's
yeah.
hell.
There's,
right?
I think it's the Witch's Mountain or whatever.
Oh, the Witch's
probably.
Mountain. Okay,
yeah.
He's like dragging his body. He's
yeah.
dragging his body while he's flying.
Yeah.
It's a great shot.
It is. And that's another great expressionistic moment, because he just sets him down on that thing that sets
yeah.
the rock on top of him, and basically just like points
yeah,
at him and like
yeah.
says, "You stay there." Basically, kind of.
Specifically, the moment that I'm thinking of that I definitely liked was the scenes where he like was around the girls and it got romantic, you know?
Yeah.
And like
okay.
the background would change to like pink or whatever,
yes,
like
yes.
a warm color, like.
That's the demon world with the.
Yeah, I thought that was cool.
Yeah, yeah.
But honestly, I don't know why. I'm finding a lot of these moments to kind of merge together. But I don't know if that's my memory or just the movie, but like...
What do you mean by merge together, though?
Like, it's like I can't even think of, like... It's hard to think of specific moments because
oh, okay,
like,
okay.
they're all, like, jumbling together. Like.
I mean, maybe that is a good... Like, it does kind of feel sane. Like, you're just watching... Because of the story, mainly, but...
Yeah. I mean, he does a lot of the same things, because it's just, like, him flying... Like, he figures out how to fly the flying horse,
yeah,
and they
yeah.
lose the flying horse, and they get the flying horse back, I feel like, and they lose it again, or something like that. Or no,
then, and
like,
then Aladdin kind of gets
yeah.
involved in the middle, like, kind of
which
random,
is, like,
kind of
just random,
yeah. Yeah,
because
yeah.
no, like, he needs Aladdin's, like,
yeah.
magic
oh,
lamp.
Yeah, the lamp, yeah. Even though the genie, or the djinn... There's a great shot of him coming out.
There is, yeah.
That's the thing. It's more about the shots that in specific moments.
It's
and
more
I,
about the art, like
yeah,
the
art.
Yeah.
And that's why I really like. I definitely need to read 1001 Nights at some point. Or Arabian.
Yeah. I think it's Arabian
Nights. Arabian
this
Nights.
One.
Yes,
this one's
yes.
Arabian Nights. I think.
I need to read that at some point because.
For sure.
And then come back and watch this. You know, knowing the characters, then you could just kind of see them come alive almost. You know,
yeah,
but it just
sure.
feels like I don't know the characters enough.
Yeah.
Like, I know Aladdin from the Disney movies. That's,
yeah,
that's probably
exactly.
a problem, you know?
That's probably the problem.
Is Aladdin, like, where did Aladdin originate from, that, you know, character?
Probably Arabian Nights, honestly.
Yeah.
It might be.
Even though Arabian Nights is probably based on older stories.
Probably,
you know?
Yeah.
So, you never, that's a good question. Yeah. Something we're not educated enough on.
It's one of you.
But, honestly, we can probably come to, like, we didn't love the movie as a movie. I appreciate it more for
oh,
the history.
As an art piece, it's
yes,
beautiful.
Yeah. And
yeah, I just don't know if it works in the movie. You know?
And to give her credit, this is one of her first earlier movies. Not first, but one of her early. Like, she made movies all the way up until the 50s and 60s.
Yeah.
You know, so...
She definitely has potential. Like,
yeah,
this makes so much sense why he finds out about Aladdin in China now, because apparently he's a Chinese. He's Chinese.
He's Chinese?
Apparently, dude. Like, their original story is it's set in China, and he's Chinese.
I mean, they do go to the Emperor of China.
No, exactly. Like, that makes so much more sense now. Yeah. Like, why they go to China.
Yeah.
But,
huh. Yeah, you learn something new.
You learn something new every day.
I would not have guessed that.
No,
it doesn't sound like Aladdin does not sound like a Chinese. Maybe
no.
He had a different name.
Yeah, I don't know.
China,
yeah.
Probably, because that does not sound like a Chinese name. But do you guys, I don't know, we went off kind of on a tangent, but do you guys have any last words on this, Prince Achmed? The first,
because
we are about to go to Miyazaki, so it is kind of...
No matter my thoughts on it, definitely still watch it.
Yeah.
It's not that long.
It's not a silent movie you've probably ever seen before, honestly.
Yeah,
so, like, that alone makes it worth watching.
Or just a movie you've never seen before,
and, like,
honestly.
People think of silent movies as black and white. This movie is colorful as all hell, so...
And... I even was talking about this before we did the episode. It's almost not a silent movie in some ways because it is carried by the music the whole time. And it was composed at the time with them making it. You know, it's not like a lot of silent movies where they're just playing a random score or something.
Yeah.
Or something made after. This was actually made for the score. And a lot of the movements, you can feel that.
Yeah,
right?
You can.
They're definitely timed with the music. So there's a lot of reasons to watch it. Like, it kind of is. A turn your brain movie off in some ways if you're not really going to care about the story, and you probably will not at some point, you know, especially if you don't love the characters already. But it's worth watching for the art style, for the history, etc., etc.
Yeah.
But on a better note, let's go to the better movie we're going to review from 1926. Because this one, to me, is definitely an all time great movie, no matter the year, no matter when it was made, all that kind of thing.
It is, in my opinion, too.
And this is not even my pick, so, Blake, why'd you pick this?
Yeah, so Cage of Madness is what I picked. And I did pick it because this is my favorite silent movie still, thankfully. Like, maybe not thankfully, because I love Chaplin's movies, and I have watched more Buster Keaton now, too. But I love this movie so much, and the reason is because it's, like, it's so far ahead of its time. Like, the shots that they use in this movie, I feel like you don't even see until, like, the 50s or 60s in horror movies. Yeah. Like, specifically that scene where it's, like, I think it's, like, at the 50-minute mark where he's just in that jail cell, like, looking away, or, like, he's like kind of, like, zoning out, and then the jail cell just keeps on, like, going over, like, passing over his face. Like, the overlays that they have in this movie are freaking insane.
Yeah, there's
there are so many great overlays, and that's really the main reason why I chose it, is because it is so far ahead of its time, and I think Japanese silent cinema has just, like, this special quality, kind of, where it kind of has lost something, because, like, all Japanese cinema had, like, benshis telling the stories, like, along with the movies.
Yeah,
like, each theater would have a different benshi, and these people would go to the movie to see the benshi, not even just for the movie, but because they like the benshi telling the story, because, like, they'd watch the movie and, like, make their own interpretations on it, and, like, add dialogue, and then they'd, like, read over the movie, basically. And, like, so people would go and see those, and we've lost that with Japanese cinema, obviously, like, silent cinema. Like, we will never be able to know what that was like.
Yeah.
So, like, I honestly, like, would love to go back to 1926 and watch this in Tokyo or something, because that would be amazing, but...
But, okay, you thinking and saying that just reminded me, because I hadn't even thought about that, because you mentioned all the shots, obviously, the overlays and all that, right? And one of the awesome things about why this movie could only be made in Japan... was there was no way a mainstream movie or kind of mainstream movie, I don't know how mainstream this one was, but obviously it was a studio movie. This could never have been made in America or even Europe at the time. And because, and that reason you said, what were they called?
Benshis.
Benshis, yes. This thought just came to me. Like, the reason they were probably able to be so experimental with the images and didn't have to worry as much if people were following along with the story was because they had those people, you know, telling you the story along, right? So really, even the filmmakers could be like, oh, we know someone's going to be telling the story.
Exactly.
We can focus on these. We can do some really cool stuff with the shots and everything.
Yeah.
And someone can explain it if someone doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah.
But for us watching now, it's like, how are they even able to do this? You know?
Yeah.
And even me at times, I was like, if you don't know the story, like, it just jumps into the story.
It does.
You know,
it really does.
You know a lot, like, or you just have to get it through the images, right? Like, and that kind of,
like,
makes it fun.
Like, at least read the synopsis. Or if you want to know the story. If you don't, you can just, like, jump in. It's fine. But, like, if you just jump in, you, like, just see a bunch of rain hitting everything. You're like, what the fuck is going on? What is this? And then it goes right into the mental asylum.
It's amazing, though, at the same time. The dancing girl.
Yes.
the dancing girl. This kind of makes me feel better because the whole time I was like, I'm so confused. What's going on?
Oh yeah. There's a reason. There's this very specific cultural reason why that is the case.
But it's interesting in terms of Japanese silent cinema that like something like this is made, but then you also watch something like an Ozu silent movie, and they're like, wow.
Yeah.
These are both like they're like so different.
Yes.
Like,
literally they're just allowing more creators to have more freedom and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
I know that Joseph Anderson, who's like he's a big Japanese like history expert, but like I know on a Page of Madness, the Blu-ray, they have like an interview with him and a psychiatrist actually, and I think that he was saying that Teisuke Kinosaga, maybe, I can't remember who directed this movie, but they were saying that he actually did watch a lot of like Eisenstein, I think, also
montage for sure.
Yeah, because that's where he got a lot of the ideas at least for these shots.
Yes.
But like I feel like he built upon these shots are just freaking insane, dude. It goes right to the dancing girl, and like the shots with that dancing girl in the very opening scene of that mental asylum is just insane because you're like, people did this in 1926. Like what?
Yeah, like I just love them the camera just keep on like jumping from people to person, just like
yeah,
really creatively.
Yeah, and like one of my first notes for this movie was like, 5 minutes and I was like, I didn't even know people moved the camera like this in the 20s, dude. Like,
oh yeah,
because like we just watched Chaplin and stuff like that, and he moves his camera, but like not a lot.
Very
and
early,
like,
yeah,
and then this movie, you can almost get like motion sickness if you're that like adept to it because of how like fast he's moving the camera basically and just twirling it around. It seems like
and to me, that's what makes it it fits the story.
Yeah,
perfectly. Right.
No, this is one of the best tales of descending to madness is.
Oh
sure.
Man, and because it's the perfect combination of yes, they're doing all these amazing experimental stuff. You know, with the camera and the montage is really good. But the reason why it feels like a great movie too, because it fits the story, maybe not even the story, but the kind of feeling it's trying to portray, right? Of a man falling into madness because of losing a wife, basically, you know, watching her, you know, go into madness herself. And, like, it has that, almost like Chaplin, that dual nature of it, right?
Yeah.
Like, you're watching it because it's cool and it's a great movie, but at the same time, it hits deep at the same time.
It does hit deep.
You know? And watching the ending this time, we should get to the, okay, I don't want to even just, we should at least talk about some of the key scenes and stuff in the movie. I'll start. One of my favorite uses of the experimental technique and how it fits the story is when we get her point of view from her shots. Like, there's one where she's like basically laughing and the husband's staring at her.
Yeah.
And she stares back and his face like just starts stretching. I'm like, oh my, like how'd they even think of this?
Yeah, dude.
You know? And it's like, it just fits perfectly. But there's like a lot of little reflection shots they use where like, there's another one where she's like under a tree, like looking at an apple when her family's like right behind her.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden you see her POV and then it's like just reflected, like really, like you could just tell she's gone mad, right?
Yeah.
And it's just a perfect way to like, you could tell they probably thought of the shots first.
Yes.
And then they're like, how can we use this
like
in
that.
A story? Like, you know, how can we like how can we use a shot like this in a story? You know.
Yeah. Well, yeah, a shot that I was really impressed by, and this kind of shot I'm very impressed by, but all silent movies, there's a similar one in Cameraman as well that we're gonna talk about. But when all the prisoners are going like berserk in the prison. Just like that kind of scale in a silent movie is always really impressive for me.
Yeah,
like all those actors,
especially with the frame rate.
Oh yeah,
because
you know,
it's faster, right?
And are you talking about the one,
like,
the time whenever he kills the doctor, like the dream, kind of like that's all in his head, kind of like that whole thing is basically in his head. Is that the scene you're talking about where he starts beating the doctor with the shovel?
Yeah, I just remember like I don't know
because there are a few of those.
Story wise,
like,
I have no idea. I just remember they were going berserk. All right,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Well,
no, there are a few of those scenes where the inmates
they're all impressive anyway. Like
because
one of my favorite times when they go berserk is when they're all watching her dance for the first time.
Yeah,
and it's like
they're all trying to see her dance.
And it kind of just, to me, it just meant like every time they watch her dance and stuff, it just, to me, it thinks of like even these people that are going mad, they still have an appreciation of art or something, you know,
something
like
that.
I don't know exactly what he meant by it, but I like it. I don't know exactly
yeah,
what
see,
it means.
See, what I got from that is I was like, she's like the maestro for the madness almost, is like how I kind of got it.
Like, you think she's the one making the mad?
I don't know.
Because
if
of her dancing?
Maybe. Like that,
okay,
or like that, like,
see,
taps,
I can see that for
taps
sure,
into
yeah.
something. I don't know.
Like, art makes you insane?
Yeah, maybe, okay.
That's the thing. It's open, and that's the thing. So a lot of this movie is open, right? It's all images, and they're coming fast too. A lot of the time.
Yes, they are. No, that's one of the best things also about this not having like any title cards basically at all. Is because like you don't have to pay attention to that, thankfully. Yeah. Like because you do get to just get fully absorbed in the madness, like, you know, like where you're just watching all these images play before you, and then you're like,
you're
what did I just watch, dude? Like you're like, what did I just watch?
You're part of the asylum, honestly.
Yeah, you are. No, and one of my favorite things rewatching it is I actually did get the story a little bit more, and this time like it really is. Maybe not like a forerunner in Japanese. I mean, it is a forerunner of Japanese cinema, obviously, because it was so early. But it was like a lot of Japanese cinema is about like the conflict between like being obligated to something and like what you actually want. You know, because like this movie starts off with him wanting to be a sailor, but like, or like actually he chose his like human feelings over his obligation and like went off to be a sailor while his wife was going insane. And now he's back
he feels guilty.
Back here dealing with his obligation, not like actually doing what he wants to do.
Yeah.
And like a lot of Japanese cinema is like that, where it's like or just like anyone is like dealing with like they want to do something else, but then like they're drawn to something here. You
the
know?
Individual versus
it's keeping
the
them
individual
here.
Desire versus like what's their cultural duty or something.
Yeah. And like you get that heavily in this movie because he does feel like you can feel that he feels a lot of guilt. And it's not even only guilt. It is just like he himself is descending into madness. Obviously, watching his wife go mad. Because just think about watching. I know people have like relatives that go through like dementia and stuff like that, and that's hard.
Yeah,
that's really hard. And I do think that that's one reason why this connects
a
lot is because it feels real. And that's one reason why I actually liked watching that the interview with the psychiatrist and Joseph Anderson afterwards, because that's what the psychiatrist says, is he's like, this is one of the best portrayals of descending into, like, regressing and descending into madness along with someone that that can be portrayed, because it, like, this would be, like, an actual reaction that someone would have to watching the situation, kind of.
Oh. And to me, it's, like, it's what the best horror or genre movies can do, right? Where it's, even though the images itself are, you know, can be extreme or experimental or however you want to define the image in this movie, it still feels real at the end of the day. It's speaking about a real experience, you know?
Yeah.
Like, when you think about that real experience, you might even think of the movie.
And just think,
because
this is showing specifically 1920s asylums of Japan.
That's
like,
it's
a period piece in that sense of the word. Like, this is actually what asylums were like. I mean, okay, the portrayal of, like, the doctors especially and the janitor himself. Like, that stuff is all completely, like, how asylums were run back then in the day.
Why people might have had mistrust of doctors, you know, or, you know, if they were going to the same time and stuff.
Yeah, or why she even might want to stay there, because she feels safer there than out in the real world where she might have to deal with reality
also
again,
true,
you know? Like, maybe she just likes being in the care of authoritarian doctors more so than, like...
That's a good point.
I don't know. Yeah, it's...
Because we really never get, like... Does she ever she never changes the whole movie? I don't think
she never
really,
wants
he's
to
the
go.
One, he's the
wants,
one that,
he
he's
wants,
the one that ends
yeah.
up staying.
He stays in the asylum with her.
Yeah.
He kind of goes mad.
That's kind of what the movie's about, right?
It
with
is.
The mask and everything at the end.
That's we can get to the end.
Yeah,
now,
we'll
see
the
ending
because the ending's amazing.
Creep me out.
Yeah.
So
to me, it really I hate to bring up Chaplin again, but it really ties the whole movie together.
It does.
With a great ending. You know, it's like because I was watching it and even like. And that's to me what makes it a great even story. Even though it is hard to follow maybe the first time you watch it, once you know what's going on, the ending really hits home in terms of what it's trying to say, right? Where it's like, you think, oh, maybe he will get his wife out, and he's having the fantasies and stuff of getting her out, right? And he like gives her food at one point and everything, but it kind of is more realistic in terms of it might be like when one person in a spousal relation that long goes crazy, the other one might go crazy too. You know, that kind of thing. Where it's not just going to be a happy ending, you know, when that does happen in real life.
I even just love specifically the scene where he puts on the mask because he puts the mask, well, first his wife puts on the mask, and then, like, they put the mask on two children, basically meaning, like, he has his family back together. Like, this is finally, like, he has his family back together, basically. Like, it took him going insane and putting on the mask of madness, kind of just like everyone else, but, like... He got his family back by doing this.
It's creepy as hell.
And it is creepy as hell.
And then, great shot too, because it literally goes. You see them both put the mask on, and the camera goes down, shows the kids, because you're not expecting kids to be there, right? So then it shows them in mass. So like it makes that point, like you're saying. And then the camera comes back up to him mopping the floor in the insane asylum, right? Basically saying like he's he's in there now. Like,
yeah, that, like, you don't know how much of this, how, like, if any of that is even real. Like, yes. What just happened?
Oh,
like,
that's one of my favorite parts of the movie. Yeah. Like, thinking about it this time, there's flashbacks. There's dreams, you know, there's...
It's hard to tell what's real.
You don't know if the crazy person is the one having the thought or not,
yeah.
You know.
And I actually wanted to bring this up because like, the Japanese title for this movie can literally be translated in two ways, and they're both, like, the right way to translate. And one is A Page of Madness, as it's actually called, and the other is A Page Out of Order.
No.
And there is a scene. There is a specific scene where a guy, if you remember, where one of the guys is sitting at a table with manuscripts, and a breeze blows and blows all the manuscripts out of order.
Yes.
And it's like kind of just saying like both titles are kind of right, you know. Like, it is A Page of Madness, but it's also like you don't know what order this movie's in, you know, like, because it is a page out of order too. Like,
that's actually a good point. Even the you could even see the movie is not even in sequential order, really.
Yeah.
It's one of the early. It's got to be one of the early movies of doing that thing where you go from dreams to flashbacks to memories to, you know, flash forwards and all, just all of it kind of and making it the same kind of movie.
Yeah,
you know?
It's such an impressive movie.
It really is. Like, and now that I'm like, this is what I love about watching great movies a lot. When you just get over the story and stuff, and you can really just because then you know it, and you can just let the images come over you and stuff. And this has just some of the best ever.
Yeah,
and knowing it's not like. I didn't know he was an Eisenstein fan, but it makes so much sense.
Yeah.
I mean, how could he not be? Just with the use of montage in this, it's amazing. Like, just from the opening scene with the rain, like you mentioned earlier, where there's just a bunch of quick cuts all of a sudden, like, you know it's going to be... You know you're getting it for something right away.
Yes,
you know?
you definitely do.
Like, it doesn't hold back, basically. Yeah. I kind of love movies like that, especially if you can make the story work with it.
Yes. And that's one thing that it does work with it, thankfully, that it still works with it, but I really do wish that we could at least go back and see it in 26 with the Benchies.
That would have been amazing.
Because that
was its own kind of art.
Yeah.
You know,
it was
its
own. Like,
they were
as popular as the movies. Like, people would actually go to the theater just to see the Benchies and not for the... Like, they would go for the movie, obviously, but they would go to their favorite theater with their favorite Benchie to see the movie because they wanted to see his interpretation on the movie.
Yeah.
Not anyone else.
That's how oral traditions were passed down for a long ass time, you know? People were going to hear people say it, say a story.
Something we're never going to get it again, sadly, probably, but...
Unless it's like, you know, some niche theater that you have to go to. Like,
I'd go.
Oh, yeah. That'd actually be cool, though.
It would
they
be
should
awesome.
Do something like that.
They
it's,
should
it'll
do
probably be in
like
New York
that,
City
yeah.
for like, you know, you have to have $10,000 to go. But, but that'd be cool, though. We can watch online.
We can watch it online.
But
before we get done with this, I do want to mention there's a similarity I saw between this and another movie, specifically the look of the crazy people. I don't know. Did you guys notice they kind of in High and Low the people in the drug? You know.
I know the scene you're talking about. Yes.
Yeah, like
I can see
they
what you're
look
saying.
Similar.
Yes.
I noticed that when I was watching. I was like, dang.
This movie definitely had an influence on
some. This movie.
Kurosawa
really...
was a whole generation after this movie.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, this movie influenced so much. Like, it influenced basically every movie about madness that came after it. Like,
it gave me in some ways, like, it's not the same themes, but it reminded me of The Shining in some ways. Just
for sure.
With the guy going crazy, you know? In
for
a horror genre. Like, a psychological horror, you know?
Yeah.
And where it goes backwards almost. He's not gonna, you know, the guy's getting worse by the end.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But do you have any last words, Blake, on this? Or
no, I'm glad that you guys liked it as much as I do, though.
Okay,
so,
yeah. Oh,
that's what I'll say.
Honestly, yeah, I loved it this time, but honestly, when I rewatch it, I think I might like it even more.
Yeah, that was your first watch.
Yeah.
I will say that it works both as completely silent, or if you watch it with the YouTube channel one, or wherever you watch it with the score, too. Like, it works...
I should mention that before. I didn't like the score as much. I think I mentioned that before.
Yeah, you mentioned that to us.
Like, to me, it the score did take away from the image just a little bit, just because it was...
See, I really love
loud.
The score.
I would like it on its own,
yeah.
But to me it was kind of like almost outplaying the images at some point, you know, trying to be loud. Like,
I thought that they did a good job of, like, playing it and playing like making that play along with them. That was just my opinion, though. Like, I like the period specific instruments they used too.
I would say this: if you like it, it's worth watching with the score and then watching silent, like, no score or anything
for sure.
You know?
Because Dany and I both watched this completely silent the first time, and it was. I mean, I loved it the first time I watched it. So
it can be a bit jarring though for a silent movie with no music though, because like you're almost
if
alone.
They're not expecting.
That's true.
You're like alone in your own thoughts, like.
No, and a lot of silent most silent movies had music playing with it.
Yeah,
some people play music, but
it is,
you would never know. It was hit or miss with what music they were playing, you know.
Yeah.
So just kind of like now. But other than that,
that's what I ran to when I was watching Maya Darren. Like there was one for Private Life of a Cat.
Yo.
And yeah, and there was like YouTube one. It's like this like more modern one, and like I was kind of liking it. I was like, dang, I like this music. Sounds pretty modern though. Like what?
Sounds pretty modern.
I was like, what? Oh, she's.
I mean, there were some that her husband did that before she died. She married someone that he did some scores for some of her movies. That's kind of off topic. But
yeah. Anyway,
I mean, she's silent. She's silent too.
Honestly, yeah, she is one of the best. But any last words on a Page of Madness, Blake?
No. I'm ready to get to the camera person.
It's not even the cameraman.
It's just cameraman. Yeah. And Luke, so why'd you pick this one?
Yeah, so this is my pick, and really, this really just boils down to me, like, this movie, I feel like it's only, like, what, 70, 80 minutes? And it's like a really nice, you know, sweet, comedic, romantic comedy, you know, silent romantic comedy. It's, like, it's extremely easy to watch. It's almost like The Circus in that way, like, for me. Like, I love it because, like, I can just watch it anytime, mm-hmm. really, and just, like, have a good time, you know, turn my brain off. And, you know, he has amazing gags in this, Buster Keaton, you know, amazing stunts, a monkey shoots machine guns, you know, great stuff. Any silent movie with an animal, honestly, like, it's going to be, like, super fun to watch and amazing.
Are there any more animals in this?
There's a monkey, definitely.
I know the monkey. Don't forget about the monkey.
It's very important, all right? Not that I remember, despite all the comedic stuff, like, I think I do love, like, the romance in this movie. I think it's super sweet and, like, has a great ending to it.
It does.
Yeah.
It does.
So, yeah, honestly, it's just a lovely movie you could pop on anytime and just enjoy. So...
That's true. I agree with that for sure.
Yeah. That's why I love it so much.
Yeah.
That's why I hate it. No, I'm kidding.
That's why I hate it.
also, some of the set pieces in this movie are insane.
No, oh, really. Sure. That's probably a Keaton theme.
Yeah.
But that's definitely one of the reasons, not even the main reason, but one of the reasons to watch it. There's some great set pieces in this.
Keaton being Keaton. I don't know where I was going with that, but yeah.
Even the story for this one, I actually kind of like. Like, it's kind of simple, you know. Just,
yeah.
But it's still like, you know, you're just trying to be a TV camera guy, you know, the 20s, trying to get news stories.
Yeah, and trying to, you know, fall in love with the secretary, like get the girl at the same time. It's just, I love, like, specifically the scene where she calls him and like they're on the phone she's like, my date's over, and he just immediately like runs over and she's like still on the phone with him. That's so funny.
That's one of my favorite moments. And then the baseball scene where he basically pantomimes a whole baseball hitting a home run and everything is like, I could watch that forever, you know. Like, that's, like, to me, it's amazing. Like, that's some of my favorite Chaplin moments, too, is where he just, like, pantomimes the whole, like, kind of event.
Oh, yeah.
Or we've already mentioned Tati's Parade once this episode, and I mentioned it again. Tati also does that a lot. He does tennis.
Oh, but, yeah, tennis,
you know, fishing. He was a huge Keaton fan, so.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean,
Blake, did you say why you liked it? Or?
No, I really like it as well. I think the story is simple. I also like the story.
Yeah.
I think that's a good thing for it. I don't know, but the Buster Keatons that I've watched this week, he hasn't gone like super story heavy, which is fine. Like, he is more so set piece heavy and like gag heavy, and I do like that. And like one of my favorite gags in this movie is actually, like, I think it's like one of the longer ones. It's like whenever he's like in the dressing room with the other fat dude, and he's they're getting changed. It's a long scene. Like, that's what I wrote down whenever I was watching. I was like, this is a long scene, but like the payoff is so good.
Yeah, and the ending, like, when he cuts, you think it's over, and then he drops out with, like, the long, you know, large.
Yeah, because, like, the fat guy walks out first with, like, Buster Keaton's suit on. He's like, what is this? And then Buster's, like, you see him walk out.
You see Buster first, actually.
Do you see Buster? Yeah. I thought that you saw the other guy first, because then, like, the reveal comes with Buster Keaton after, I thought. But...
No, you're, like, when I saw, I think Buster Keaton comes out first, because I remember, like, thinking, like, oh, wow, that's, like, a... It's a weird swimsuit. I guess that's what swimsuits look at.
Because he sneaks out first.
Yeah.
Trying to get away.
Yeah.
And then the big guy comes out with the tiny one.
Yeah.
He's like, what?
Yeah. No, and the payoff for that is not even like that gag. It's the gag of him like losing his pants completely. Because it goes like that. This gag leads in like three other gags that he does.
And him losing the date, or you think he's going to lose the date because of that, like it honestly kind of hurts a little bit. When
it does.
Like, oh, damn. Like, this
and
guy
then he gets, but he gets her back, which is
all
good.
Or yeah, he gets out somehow.
He does the classic Charlie Chaplin kicking someone in the ass and get into a river. No, into a pool. No.
Honestly, like when thinking about like the gags into other gags, I specifically also think of the. You know, initially when he gets the story about the fire, and then he runs out, and he actually, you know, breaks the window in the door with the camera, and he's like, oh, no, and then, like, he, like, runs away. But then when he gets told about the Chinatown thing, he like, starts to go, and he realizes, oh, wait, I don't want to do this again. And he opens the door, and goes past it, and then the wind blows the door, and then it breaks the glass.
And then it breaks the glass again. And then the next time you come in, it has bars on both sides instead of just the one side.
I didn't even notice that.
Yeah. Oh, you didn't notice that?
I didn't notice that either.
Okay, because, like, the first time he comes in, it doesn't, like, it's just a normal door. The second time he comes in, there's bars on the side that he broke the first time. And then he walks out, and then it breaks on the other side. And then the second time he comes in, there's bars on both sides of the window, so it doesn't happen again.
I could talk about the gags in this movie all day long, to be honest. But
I mean, we should talk about the Tong War, because Dany and I both had this thought, apparently, but I wrote it down like while I was watching. I was like, was this the first Nightcrawler movie? Like, damn.
Because he plants evidence. He's trying to get a fight going, basically, you know, for the camera.
He's doing what the news always does and instigates everything.
Yeah, he needs a story, you know?
See, that's actually, like, part of the social like a lot of Buster Keaton movies don't have, like, a ton of social commentary, and this one could have gone farther.
Yes,
but, like, it at least is there.
That's the thing. I don't know if it's there because it was just funny.
Yeah, I don't know if it's there.
Or if it's there because he's actually trying to make that point, like, oh, news people, you know, that's what they're actually doing. They're just, you know, they're here to try to see fights coming, basically, for
news. He does paint the news people in the movie are painted in a bad, negative light.
Though. They are, yeah.
Not him, though.
But he's not a newsman yet.
Yeah. McKean's the one that literally puts a knife in one of the one they're fighting, like just trying to like get a murder on camera, basically.
Like the boss, the boss of the news company, he's portrayed as an asshole. Like,
oh yeah, that's true.
The one of the people who work for it that tries to
steal a girl.
Of course, yeah. So, I mean, I would say I think he was aware he was making a social commentary, to be honest.
It is a funny scene either way.
It's a great scene. It's that whole Tong War stuff is just hilarious.
Because you're kind of on his side too. You're like, I just want to get him. I want him to get some good footage. You know? Yeah.
And then the monkey. I don't understand.
It all
like,
comes back to the monkey.
Yeah. It has to be a live monkey, but like, I don't know. How do they train a monkey to do that? That's crazy.
Monkeys are smart, dude.
Yeah, it's insane. And like,
kill the monk.
The sailor.
I love how he gets the monkey, dude. It's just like, they think he died. Okay, so like, they think he dies. Then he's like, okay, you pay him for it. And then like, he pays him for it. And then he's like, it's your monkey now. And he's like, what do I do with the dead
then
monkey?
Put
the sheet over it. Well, just to grab it and carry it. They like, tries to leave it on the trash can.
Oh my god.
That's another. That's kind of like a kid actually.
That,
remember, child,
when you
child,
said
child,
that,
yeah.
It literally just reminded me of a kid. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and the sailor uniform on it just caps it off too. Like it's just so cute. Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Plus, there's another great. This is true with a lot of silent comedies, and we need to get more back to this. Just making fun of cops, making them look dumb. You know.
No, this is before Copaganda got full.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Got, like,
There's some great moments of him getting away from a cop, you know.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
You gotta have that.
Well, like that cop was just like on the entire movie for like why? Like why is he just like watching?
He's just like watching.
Yeah,
he's
just like watching.
He's like suspicious because Keaton's on a date. You know?
Yeah, he's like, where are you going? They're just like that. I'm like, what is this guy's problem, man? Like he's living his life.
Yeah, he asks him where he works. Where he lives.
Yeah, like what is your what? Like why you need to know? And the Buster's like pointing like I live over there and over there.
Oh, that's a great moment where he points both.
Yeah, he points both directions.
Oh man.
No, and I just love the shot at the very end where like Buster has saved the girl and everything, and then like he's just sitting there with all the medicine, and then the camera pulls out and you see the monkey rolling the camera.
That's the scene I want to talk about.
Okay,
though, that's my favorite scene.
I love
just
that
whole scene
so much,
like,
dude. It's so good.
Like just the fact that it's like you think like you're like, oh wow, Buster Keaton's like, you know, he's he doesn't get the girl, but then you realize, oh wait, the monkey
saved the day.
Got it.
The monkey's the deus ex machina.
And the fact that he's like, I don't even realize, I still don't get how he got the film from Chinatown thing. Like, he lost it, but then he got it back somehow.
He puts in a different canister back in or something, right?
I think so. Yeah,
yeah. I don't...
Like, I think he was filming with the real film, but then, like, it got switched out whenever he...
The monkey takes one out. I see the monkey take one out, and then he's like, what is the monkey doing? Yeah. And he puts one back in. Like, yeah. I guess the one he puts in is... Well, it was empty.
That's
the one
real
he puts in was empty. Had no film in it, I think.
Well, no, the
it
one he puts like in before shooting... Like, because, like, the monkey takes out the film, and then he makes sure to put it back in, like, as he's filming the war. So I think he puts in the right one, but I think after that, the monkey takes it out again.
Maybe that's what
and
happened.
Switches.
Yeah,
like,
because yeah.
he filmed all the stuff, so he did film it, but...
The film somehow loses...
Yeah, I think it, like, gets switched or something,
yeah.
or something
I do
happens.
Remember, it's not clear the way it's filmed, I don't think.
Yeah, but it doesn't really matter.
No, it doesn't really matter.
I mean, somehow they find the film.
Yeah.
And it is a great shot, though,
of
him holding the medicine, and then the camera pans out, and you see the...
Yeah, and then you see the monkey rolling.
And the monkey just filming, too.
And then they watch it, and it's I kind of like it. It's kind of like it's a new perspective from the scene, honestly.
Yeah.
Like, from that camera, like a different.
It is.
Camera.
I'm like, how is the monkey moving this camera? Yeah. How does he know all these moments to move?
Yeah. Plus, dude, it made me think of it made me think of how fun it would have been like to be actually a news person though, and like you're watching daily, like you're trying to like you're hoping for some good footage, and you're actually in the theater having to watch it. You know, Because it actually is a great kind of montage scene of the Tong War that he actually films when they find out. Because they're like, oh, let's see what he made, you know. And it's a great shot of the tall newscaster guy, or the tall TV cameraman, who, like, actually ends up getting the girl before we find out he's been lying about everything.
Yeah.
And, like, he just slowly slinks into his shit while he's watching the whole thing, and he can't, like, stop watching. He just has to see it happen, you know. It's a funny moment.
See, like, that's another one, where, like, I don't know why Buster Keaton's such a madman, but, like, having a boat hit you at full speed, like, even in that, like, little boat he was on, it's still, like, really dangerous.
Yeah, that's
like,
insane.
That's still, like, really dangerous. Like,
yeah.
Like that boat was going full speed. It just rammed right into him.
And
like,
how was the boat going in a circle, too? Like, that was, like...
Yeah, like, that's crazy. I don't know how they tied that. Like, whenever the boat's just going around, because he's paddling his boat back in to save him, and then the boat rams into his boat.
It's almost like...
Like, that stuff's dangerous, man. Like,
the boat was basically like a shark. You know?
Yeah.
Like, just...
Oh, yeah, it was, yeah.
I mean, we should mention he's probably the first action star, right?
Yeah,
I'd say
probably.
So. Maybe,
like,
because
this is making
Lloyd
like when you describe
star?
That, like you're making me think of like when people talk about Jackie Chan and like Tom Cruise.
Oh yeah,
you know?
Everyone
how
I hear
they do that. I can't believe they did that.
Yeah.
You know, that
I hear a ton
thing.
Of people comparing Jackie Chan to Buster Keaton.
I honestly can see that.
The way they're both like crazy stuntmen, but like also comedic.
Dude, like Police Story with like doing a double feature with like Police Story and any Buster Keaton movie would be so good.
Police Story is.
But Jackie Chan's also got the facial expressions, though.
He does, yeah.
You know,
so, yeah.
He's got some great
sure.
ones. But that's what makes Keaton great, too.
Yeah.
I love his flat face, just...
Deadpan face,
the word for it, yeah. It's kind of emotionless, almost, you know? No matter what happens, it's just kind of the same
thing.
Were you going to compare the war scene to Yojimbo?
No, not the... Okay, well, kind of, though. It was more of a shot where...
Yeah.
He... wants to get a good shot, a view of the fight going on below on the street.
Yeah.
So he climbs that ladder, and the way he's looking at it, it just reminds me of Yojimbo, the same way Yojimbo's like, Yojimbo has a different attitude, obviously, but still it's the same kind of thing, you know, just watching the fight, the street fight from below, you know, trying to stay out of it. But he adds on to it, because then his whole platform falls, and the way it falls, like, while he's standing on it, like, that just would have been scary to do.
Yes,
you know?
Dude,
like,
so many
and it just looks like it's just like a 5 second gag in the movie before they go on, but that would have been crazy to do.
Another 5 second gag I just thought of actually during the war scene is when two of the legs of the camera get knocked off.
And then
he's like, oh, it's not gonna stand. So he holds it out for someone to shoot it. And now you can set it down the ground.
Yeah.
I just remember that. That's such
guerrilla filmmaking. That's fine.
No, because have you seen the movie Man with the Movie Camera?
No, I haven't.
And is that actually after this?
It's like 20s, 30s. I think it's like 20s.
Remember the opening scene of this movie is actually like an actual TV camera person filming all these cool spots, and you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
It's like, because they're showing what a TV camera person, because then it cuts to him, you know, doing his like normal photography. But that opening montage is kind of like Man with the Movie Camera.
The Cameraman came out first, so.
Oh, okay.
It came out a year earlier.
Wait, which came out first?
The Cameraman.
Oh. Man, with the Movie Camera copying Cameraman, bro.
I wouldn't be surprised if they like Keaton. It's
maybe.
Vertov made that, I'm pretty sure.
Yes, you get Vertov.
Yeah.
That.
But, We have any last words on Cameraman? Oh, man. It is one of those movies that it's just like you could just talk about the gags forever. Like, And one of my favorite things with just movies in general and how you know it's a good movie, it's like the second, even if someone doesn't remember the movie at all, if you describe just a little bit of the scene, they'll be like, oh yeah, I remember that. You know, it could be years. Like, there's a lot of Keaton moments like that where like you don't even have to remember the movie, but if you just start describing the scene, people are like, oh yeah, I remember when he did that. You know, because it just made an impression on your brain even if you didn't remember it.
Because he's insane.
He is an insane person. Yeah. Like, it's the same thing, like, whenever I was saying, like, Charlie locking himself in the cage with a lion. Like, why are you still doing this bus trailer? You can actually die, so... Yeah,
and he's out here doing, like, he's, like...
I mean, he was in good-ass shape, though. Remember, in the changing scene, he had, like, a fucking six-pack.
He did, dude. Yeah. He was in good-ass shape.
Yeah. And then Keaton's out here, like, having, like, a house fall on himself in that one-week short.
Yeah,
like,
dude. There are so many things in 1 week where I'm just like, dude, like, you could have literally died doing this movie.
The ladder, bro? Like, oh
he
my
balances
gosh.
On that ladder, and anytime a ladder moves, I'm always scared. So
yeah,
I don't know how this
It made my heart, like, it was like, oh my gosh, bro. Like,
oh my god.
Chill out. But, man,
Buster Keaton's great. We'll definitely do a series on
Buster I need to watch more Buster Keaton, honestly.
I need to, too, honestly.
I've been watching more of him after I got done with Chaplin, because I just find watching silent like, shorts in the morning is so fun. Because it's like just a quick way to start your day.
Okay.
Where it's like you just watch a silent short and then you're just kind of happy.
They do. They're like.
Especially if it's like Keaton or Chaplin or Harold Lloyd or someone, like some of these great ones. So.
I need to watch Harold Lloyd too. Yeah.
No, we'll need to talk about Keaton and Harold Lloyd.
I watched Max Linder, like a Max Linder movie recently. He's like from 1910s, dude. Mm-hmm. Like he was like one of Charlie Chaplin's influence. Yeah.
Dang.
Oh.
It's pretty good. The movie I watched is called The Grass Widower, and it's about him like making his wife so angry that she goes and moves in with her mom, and then he realizes that like house chores are way harder than they thought. So it's pretty funny. It's pretty funny, honestly.
Okay. Yeah.
No, that's what I'm just saying. I love silent movies, honestly. They're so easy to watch right now.
And now that I'm doing Chaplin, obviously, we've gotten in the flow of doing
In the flow of these silent movies.
These silent.
So
I mean, literally just from the frame rate itself, you kinda have to get used to that, sped up nature of a lot of it. But like, especially with this this story and Cameraman. It fits the pace of the movie though.
Yeah,
you know? It's kind of like they're trying to get some good action, and it's just basically the pace of the movie. But Luke, you picked any last thoughts? You want to close those out?
Good movie.
What's the best movie we talked about today?
I think Page of Madness is still my favorite silent movie,
I love
Madness. So
I mean, this
Cameraman
is just one of my favorite
good.
Horror movies too.
Page of Madness is so good.
Mine's definitely Cameraman though. It's not my
The Cameraman.
It's not like
so
my favorite silent movie. Like that, definitely be I Was Born, but it's just it's a movie everyone needs to watch.
Yes, in my opinion.
I like how you compare it to The Circus, because I do think of those very similarly. Like these are just movies that you can put on any time and watch, and it's so easy to watch. So.
Yeah.
And great poster. I don't know if the Letterboxd poster.
Yeah.
Is that the original
It's the
poster?
Guy running. It's the guy running. Yeah.
But is that
I don't know if
that's
the original.
I don't know, but it's a cool
either way. It's a great. The one on Letterboxd is a great poster.
Yeah.
I don't know. You never know with Letterboxd if it's the original poster or if it's like someone made it later. But
yeah.
Either way. We should move on to what are we going to talk about next week.
Yeah, so it's another we found two movies that are blind spots for us. One's older, one's newer. The old one is Red Beard, directed by Akira Kurosawa, and the other one is, Blake, you need to pronounce it for
me. I think it's Titane.
Okay.
Titane.
And that came out last year.
Came out last year, yeah.
Okay, and who's it directed
Julia
by?
Ducarno.
Why did I say Bonchet? I don't know if I'm saying that right. I haven't seen any of her movies.
Very popular movie in the last 2 years. I hear everyone talking about it. Like people who love it, love it.
Yeah.
And we should discuss, like, we're basically trying to come up with ideas of what to do between our breaks of our big series.
Yeah.
Because we want to give ourselves a break from watching, or to just, like, watch things that we kind of want to watch throughout the week.
Almost
instead
more random,
just,
you know, just more random.
Yeah.
And it'll give us an excuse sometimes to go more modern movies, too.
Yeah.
But this one, this idea we'll have to come back to is just blind spots.
Yeah.
And we have to find, we're trying to find movies that all three of us haven't seen that are, you know, somewhat popular.
Or at least the majority.
Yeah. But it could be, like, one person's seen it.
Yeah, maybe one person. Yeah, because we were struggling.
And they just want to, like, get the other two people to watch.
Yeah. just an excuse to watch different movies, really. Yeah. But yeah. We'll call it blank.
Which means Portrait of a Lady on Fire is definitely going to be one of the next ones.
Probably.
Yeah, because if we make it to where one person has seen it, then we definitely have way more. But all three is like, then we don't know if we want to watch it at the first place.
Yeah. So
that's kind of tough. But these two are actually really good picks.
Yeah.
Redbeard is actually crazy.
I can't believe none of us.
I mean, Blake has seen a ton of Kurosawa.
I've seen most of it. Maybe I've seen a lot of Kurosawa too.
Yeah, and Luke has seen a lot. So
I've only got like six left or something. Yeah. So this is one.
And I have a Kurosawa poster in my apartment. I still haven't seen it.
That's right. Redbeard poster.
So even worse.
No, Blake, you still have a Playtime one too.
I do still have a Playtime one. I haven't seen it.
But I think, Luke, you want to close this out?
Yeah.
I mean, we just closed it out, so.
Goodbye.
No, catch you floating through the clouds.
Yeah, there you go.